So what is the universal language? It's symbolism. It's number and symbolism and form. And number, symbolism, and form are universal regardless of the spoken tongue, which one happens to have been brought up in. And hopefully in the next hour, hour and a half, I'm going to be showing you examples of this so that you can see for yourself what actually the universal language of geometry and symbolism actually means. So we're going to jump right into it here and talk about sacred numbers embedded in everyday phenomena. We measure our life in terms of days, of 24 hours, referred to as a tropical or solar day. And it turns out that 24 of these hours are 1,440 minutes. This is one of the key numbers within the ancient canon of numerical cosmology that the ancients used to basically design and create their world. The 1,440 minutes equates to 86,400 seconds. So we see 1,440 minutes is equal to 86,400 seconds, and a 12-hour span of time, which is usually represented on the clock, 720 minutes, which equals 43,200 seconds. Space measure, we talk about a foot, we talk about of 12 inches, we talk about a square foot, and you'll notice that the square foot has the same repetition of digits, 144, as the 24 hours does. All we do is we tack a zero on that, we have the number of minutes in a day. We have a cubic foot equaling 1728. I want to call your attention to the one square yard, which is 1,296 inches. Geometry, everybody knows that a circumference of a circle is divided into 360 degrees, and that 360 degrees of arc, because each degree is subdivided into minutes of arc, there is then 60 times 360, as it says there, 21,600. And then you'll notice the 21,600 minutes of arc equals 1,296,000 seconds of arc. That's a mighty fine subdivision of a circle that would be used mostly by astronomers to measure the motion of distant stars. But notice that number, 1,296,000, and you'll see that it's the same number just raised by three orders of magnitude as the number of square inches in a square yard. Okay, now another thing you might notice about most of these numbers from 1440 to 8640, 43200, 144, 1728, 36, 1296 is that they all kabbalistically add up and reduce to the single digit 9. Notice that, all of them. Pick any one of them other than, say, with the exception of 24. But we will start by looking at how some of these same numbers and other numbers are associated with the measures of geometry. And here we have what I refer to as the alphabet of sacred geometry. And these are the simplest forms. These are the polygons. You have a circle, which is actually not a polygon, but we have an equilateral triangle, a square, and a pentagon. And each of these can be measured by the number of degrees that determine the angles of the sides. So, for example, we look at a circle, which is just a special case of an ellipse with eccentricity of zero. We've covered this already, so let's go right to the equilateral triangle, and we'll see it's 60, 60, and 60, which equals 180 degrees. Again, notice that we've got the number 9 recurring. We go to the square, which is 4 times 90 degrees, the total number of degrees defining the square is 360, the same as the circle, the same as the measure of a circle. And we measure the polygons by essentially measuring the angles of the vertices or the corners. So then likewise with the pentagon, each of the angles between successive edges is 108 degrees. So you multiply the 108 times 5 and you get 540. Again, notice, everything adds up to 9. Tetrahedron is this form right here, and it's composed of 4 of the equilateral triangles. So we have, as it says here, there's 4 triangular faces. 4 times 180 is 720 degrees. That is the total angular measure of this particular geometric form. This is known as one of the platonic solids, or regular polyhedra. Polyhedra means multiple faces. And the regular polyhedra is the family of 5, there's only 5, that have the same shape or the same polygonal face. In this case, the equilateral triangle. And then we will move on to the cube. And the cube is six faces, and they're each square, and we saw that each of those square faces had 360 degrees, 6 times 360. The important thing is to grasp that the total number of degrees in this form is 2,160. Then we'll go to the octahedron, and it has eight triangular faces. This is our octahedron right here. And they're all, you'll notice that so far the tetrahedron and the octahedron are both composed of equilateral triangular faces. So in any case, notice we're seeing a recurrence of this number that we saw, 1440. Remember, we saw that number here, the number of minutes in a day. So let that relationship sink in. The number of minutes in the time that it takes our Earth to spin exactly once on its axis relative to the sun happens to be the same number of degrees that define the octahedron. Then we have the icosahedron, which is 20 faces, all equilateral triangles. You can see if you look at the vertex of this thing, you see that there are five faces clustered around each vertex. There are 20 of these triangular faces. 20 times 180 is 3,600. So again, we have one of our nines. And then our final is our dodecahedron, my favorite shape. This is what Plato referred to the dodecahedron as being the shape of the universe itself. Okay, each pentagonal face, as we found out, each edge was 108. 5 times 108 is 540. 12 times 540, as it says, is 6,480. So again, we've got the number 9 redundantly occurring over and over again in these measures. But in this particular scheme of time, the total duration of the precessional cycle, which is 25,920 years, this is the motion of the Earth on its axis like this. The ancient number that was typically attributed to this great year cycle was 25,920 years. That great year was considered to be analogous to our annual year. And just as the annual year was divided into four seasons, a spring, summer, winter, and fall, likewise the great year was divided into four great seasons, symbolized by the four fixed signs of the zodiac, the bull, the lion, the eagle, and the man or the angel. If you divide 25,920 by 4 to determine the duration of each season, you'll discover that it's 6,480 years, which is interesting because 6,480 years, as you recall, was the total measure of the dodecahedron. So here we have this same number linking the measure of space in terms of the dodecahedron, 6,480 degrees, and the season of the great year, which was considered to be profoundly important to ancient cultures all over the world, who had various ways of representing this fourfold division of cyclical time. All right, then we have, from the ancient Chaldeans, we have what was known as the Saros cycle, which was 3,600 years. So we see a repetition of that number. The 3,600, if you recalling and are taking notes, is the number of degrees measuring the icosahedron. Then we have the decans. You'll notice that a Platonic month, which is 1/12 of the great year, right there. You divide that number by 12, you get this number, 2,160. And that number, you may recall, depending on how good your memory is the number of degrees measuring the cube, 2,160. And then you'll notice the two decans of the ecliptic, or 20 degrees of the ecliptic, is 1,440, the number of degrees in the octahedron. And one decan, or 10 degrees, if for any of you who've studied astrology, you know that the decans are important to astrological determinations. One decan of 10 degrees then takes 720 years. And so here we have all five of the Platonic solids represented in these particular time cycles. We'll be right back.
back, everybody. Welcome. Glad that you're here. I want to start off by saying an enormous thank you to everyone with what happened in the last video set I released, The God Eaters. I have been in total shock at the response. I just couldn't believe it. So I think what simply happened was I hit a nerve. So I think with this next set, it's probably not going to be as desired as the last set. But I think those that follow me and those that know my style and know where I'm pointing at in this great awakening are gonna fall right into what I'm talking about today, and fall meaning understand and completely realize why I'm talking about what I am today. And that leads to what I wanted to say to start this thing off with. As I was finishing the God Eaters video, I realized that it was going to really disillusion a lot of people. Because when people start to grasp and realize how much we've been deceived and how deeply we've been deceived and lied to in those phrases you're constantly hearing, they're going to feel extremely alienated and disoriented, because really, when you find out how deep the rabbit hole goes, all of your existential questions are no longer answered. And so the security that you once had in the religion that you believed in, or the security that you once had in the political system that you thought would be okay or would be helping you, or the medical system that you thought would heal you, and people finding out that all of these, the science that has just completely let you down of the current culture, and everyone is finding out all of these enormous enterprises have let us all down, have lied to us purposefully, and have really intentionally brought down the awareness and the potential for awareness within the society, inside each individual. And so because I knew that was the case, I really wanted the next video set that I did. Is this locked in? I don't want the light to keep changing. Sorry. I didn't want the next set that I did to just be meaningless. And secondly, I really didn't want it to be negative. I wanted the next set of videos that I did to not be a bunch of bad news and a bunch of hard realities and what we all are very tired of hearing about. And so between those two things, really at the center is identity. It's an identity crisis. And that's what we really find ourselves in, because everything by which we have identified through, whatever that is, whether you think you're a dirty carbon generator, or you're a dirty sinner, or you're a Muslim, or you're Islam, or you're a Christian or Jewish, these are all identities. These are all identities. I don't say any of those things in a negative way. These are all ways that we have identified ourselves. And when you find out that all the institutions that gave you those identities are lies, are based in a type of knowledge that really discounts human beings and dismisses their viability and victimizes, that's a big one, that victimize human beings. Because if you think you're a dirty carbon generator, you've been victimized. You see that? And if I can victimize you in what you believe about yourself, I gotcha. If I'm a controller. And so what I wanted to do with the next set I did was to encourage people to realign, to rethink their identity, and to look to nature for that identity. I'm not saying that's the answer. I'm saying that nature holds an incredible set of keys that will unlock an amazing amount of potential identity and understanding of yourself that no institution, human-made institution, can offer you. And you can experience nature just right around yourself and in and of yourself. You don't have to buy into anything. You don't have to really believe anything. You don't have to subscribe or sell your soul away to any kind of belief system or anything like that. Nature is a gift. And because you yourself are a nature creature, you will orient, you reorient, you self-organize when you look to nature for answers. And this is natural to you because you're a nature creature. It kind of solves itself. And so what I wanted to do, and as I put this together, I'm going to open this up here. What I wanted to do is I wanted to organize that in such a way that people could re-identify who they are through nature. And so the way I've set this up is like you would build a brick wall or you would build a math equation or understanding math. Each one of these four videos is going to be a stepping stone to the next one. So if you start this set on like the second or third or fourth, whatever, you're going to be disillusioned because everything builds on everything else. And this is what I discovered as I pursued these subjects. And these are the subjects that we're going to be covering. It's part of the name that I've given each of these four videos. Okay, so I've titled the overall set name as Nature as Identity. That's what I've decided to call the overall name of the set. Okay, so this is part one, an archaic revival, and we're going to be talking about sacred geometry, nested Platonic solids, Hermeticism, and music. I threw in the nested Platonic solids because that's a big part of this. But Hermeticism, sacred geometry, and music is what we're going to be talking about to begin the steps of reorienting you with your identity, with who you are, who you really are. And I'm going to point towards that because I can't tell you that. But your identity, when you go through the Great Awakening, is going to have to change. It will have to. You can't hold the same identity, whatever it was. I'm a Buddhist, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Christian, I'm a Jew, I'm a Hindi, I'm a pagan, whatever it is, okay? Whatever that identity is, that you have to relinquish that. That will have to be relinquished to pierce the membrane called the Great Awakening. You will not be able to enter into the space until you relinquish how you were instructed, how you were indoctrinated into the world. Okay, my effort here is in this first video, this part one, is to return back to the archaic aspect of you, an archaic revival, which is really what McKenna would love, because it's in honor of his idea, which was that for folks to know who they are, they have to reorient themselves back to nature.
We have gone sick by following a path of untrammeled rationalism, male dominance, attention to the visible surface of things, practicality, bottom lineism. We have gone very, very sick. And the body politic, like any body, when it feels itself to be sick, it begins to produce antibodies or strategies for overcoming the condition of dis-ease. And the 20th century is an enormous effort at self-healing. The world is not an unsolved problem for scientists or sociologists. The world is a living mystery. Our birth, our death, our being in the moment, these are mysteries. They are doorways opening on to unimaginable vistas of self-exploration, empowerment, and hope for the human enterprise. And our culture has killed that, taken it away from us, made us consumers of shoddy products and shoddier ideals. We have to get away from that. And the way to get away from it is by a return to the authentic experience of the body. Let's not whore ourselves to nitwit ideologies. Let's not give our control over to the least among us. Rather, you know, claim your place in the sun and go forward into the light. The tools are there. The path is known. You simply have to turn your back on a culture that has gone sterile and dead and get with the program of a living world and a re-empowerment of the imagination.
And so, to me, the first step is sacred geometry. That's the first step. And so we're going to talk about that. And then we're also going to talk about Hermeticism. And then we're going to talk about how music basically is, as Alan Watts used to say, the finest form of art because it reflects so eloquently and accurately reality, because music is now you see it, now you don't. Now you hear it, now you don't. And that's what life is. Now you see it, now you don't. And the world that you grew up in as a child is not the world that you're in now. You saw it, but now you don't. And it's because that is the way all of nature works. It is constantly morphing. It is constantly becoming. It is constantly expanding. It is constantly complexifying. And as a nature creature, it is your role. It is your calling. It is your inspiration to reflect those patterns, to reflect those endless cycles and habits like Sheldrake talks about, to reflect those in all ways of your life. And that includes how you understand who you are, you see? Okay, so it was my opinion when I was putting all this together that sacred geometry, hermeticism, and music were the best place to start. That's where we're going to start today. And I'm going to go ahead and show you what we're also going to be talking about. What we're also going to be talking about in the coming lectures. Okay, so here in part two, A Spectacular Cosmology, we are going to go neck deep. I mean, we're going to completely fall right into the pool of milk in electromagnetism and then ethereal to material and falling into sign. Now, we're going to deep dive with electromagnetism because you are an electromagnetic creature. The world is an electromagnetic space. The universe is an electromagnetic, for lack of a better term, mechanism. This is why spiral or sacred geometry is what forms the universe. This is why all galaxies are spirals. The world spins on its axis. And this is why we are oriented in the space that we're in is through our electromagnetism, which includes gravity. And so all the forces of nature are contained in electromagnetism, and you are an electromagnetic creature. So part of identity is just knowing the electromagnetism that you are. And then it is electromagnetism that transmogrifies the ethereal realm into the material realm. And yes, it is kind of a magical transformation. We're going to talk about that. And then falling into sign, which is a discussion of the deception of humankind. And we'll get all into that. All right, and then in the third part, part three, is the ineffable. And the funny thing is, and you guys, anybody who listens to Alan Watts will know, that I am self-contradicting. Terence McKenna used to say that if your ontology doesn't have some self-contradiction within it, it's not complicated enough. So, within this ontology that I'm showing you, that I'm offering you to see today, is a discussion of the ineffable. And the ineffable obviously means you can't speak it. So just my talking and calling the ineffable, ineffable, or the, or is, I'm contradicting myself. I'm contradicting what I'm saying the ineffable is, which is that it's ineffable. You see, it's a funny thing like that. So the ether, the monad, and the fine structure constant are what are going to help us identify with what many term as God or ultimate reality, or the all-encompassing being, or the overmind. McKenna used to call it the overmind. And so we're going to be talking about that in part three. And part one and two are a build-up to part three. So it's important that you follow order here. And then finally, in part four, we close this whole thing up, and you're not going to believe this, right? But part four, a self-organizing entelechy, and remember, entelechy is the vital principle that guides our development and character, our soul. And so this is the unspeakable, what we talk about in part three. This is the unspeakable, the ineffable, that inspires all of life, that is in all the interstices, all the spaces, no matter how small, it is filled with this ineffable. And so I'm going to try to coalesce the last three talks in part four with the tree of life, the chakras, and the tarot. And what's going to be so important to keep in mind, especially in part four, is how much the symbolism that has been passed on to us and the symbolism that's in the tarot, the chakras, and the tree of life, right? I'm going to present to you in such a way that it was originally considered, especially through Hermeticism. And I'm going to show you the symbolism in its authentic form, in the sense of it's not going to be pornographied with the way it has been tainted with religion, with science, with medicine. And the symbolism that at one time helped, was a guiding force, was a guiding light for individuals, especially at Eleusis in Greece, where they held those sacred ceremonies. It was the symbolism that would help carry the individual into this deeper understanding that I'm pointing towards that holds your identity, you see? And so I'm going to try to use the symbolism of those disciplines, of those energies, to orient you to the first three lectures. So this is going to be a saga. This is going to be an adventure. And I really hope that it comes across as I have imagined in my mind. I'd like to first off dedicate all of this to Terence. Terence was an inspiration to my life, as you know, and he would love a lecture like this because we are reorienting to the archaic. We are reorienting back to the proto-science, to the science of Plato and Aristotle, and to the ideas of Tesla. And McKenna would have loved all of this stuff. I want to also mention a special thank you to Santos Bonacci. His work in Hermeticism, Falling into Sign, and his work of helping me understand the celestial energies that have been so tainted by the dark, the cabal. And I found out about Santos through a person who wrote me in my last video set, and they asked, "Have you ever heard of Santos Bonacci?" And I was just like, "No, I've never heard of him before." And so watching his videos has just been amazing, a huge, huge inspiration. I wouldn't have done this lecture without watching his videos. So I really encourage everyone to check out his videos. He's got great stuff. He has a lot of amazing things to say and a lot of very encouraging things to say about you as a human being. And then finally, I'd like to give a special thanks to this America Hidden on X. Some of their work has been really inspirational, especially in regards to the tarot and what I'm going to be doing in the final set. There's also some meaty stuff that came out of studying their posts. And so I would encourage you to check them out. They have some very, very intriguing posts, especially in regards to Hermeticism. So I just wanted to say a huge thank you to them for their work on X. Okay. Now we really begin the study. Let's start with this quote here from Nikola Tesla. "If you want to find the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, frequency, and vibration." Okay. I know that some of the things that I'm going to say throughout these four lectures, you're going to have very, very strong disagreement with. Stay calm. It's okay. I am a cynic, okay? I don't subscribe to anything. I'm a doubter by nature, okay? And so I'm not the type of person that subscribes to any one belief, and most people are. Most people depend upon beliefs to make sense of the world. I'm not that kind of person. And so I don't hold any particular belief in a higher regard than any other particular belief. I consider all of them vantages. Not anything to completely hold to, depend on for understanding, but vantages to consider as you amalgamate your own understanding. That's my approach. And so I'm not going to be reverent to some things that you would consider to be the ultimate aspect of life to revere. I'm not going to be a person that's going to do those kind of things. So my statements are not in any way to be irreverent of maybe something that you really believe in, but simply to offer a different perspective. And I say this quote to say that every single perspective I'm going to offer you in all four of these lectures are hung in the balance of this statement. Because I do subscribe, if I'm going to subscribe to anything, and here's the contradiction and the complexity of my ontology, if I am going to subscribe to anything, this idea of, if I want to know the secrets of the universe, I'm going to orient myself to energy, frequency, and vibration, to me that's a good idea. If you orient your perspective from one of energy, frequency, and vibration as the common denominators of assimilating what you are experiencing and seeing and learning to know in nature and yourself, right? You've got the right idea. You're on a good basis upon which to stand. So understand, everything that I'm going to be saying is based on Nikola Tesla's philosophy, Nikola Tesla's consideration of the world. So if you disagree with me or think that I'm crazy, it's most likely that you're also saying that Nikola Tesla is crazy, because I'm just going to be parroting a number of his philosophies and basis for putting the world together. That includes the 3, 6, or 9 and all that stuff that you always hear about in the sacred geometry. Okay, now, so to open this up and to further elucidate the statement from Tesla here, energy, frequency, and vibration, I'm going to use a little story from my past as a true story, and this ties into how we're going to begin to open up on understanding ourselves from the point of energy, frequency, and vibration. Okay, so more than 10 years ago now, I had cancer, I fought cancer, and I beat cancer. And my philosophy when I went into the ordeal, when I found out I had cancer, was to ignore all Western medicine advice. So any doctor that subscribed and had a degree in Western medicine, I basically ignored or took with an enormous grain of salt. Because not everything in Western medicine is bad. I'm not that type of person. They're great with mechanical fixes, but they're not real good with hardcore disease fixes. Okay, so knowing that, I knew when I contracted cancer, when I discovered I had cancer, I knew that I wasn't going to go down the Western medical path. Now, this put me into an extremely precarious position, because I'm not a doctor. And so to find advice, to find, you know, how am I going to navigate this? I'm foolish if I try and jump into it by myself without any help, without any advice from somebody. What am I to do? And so I chose 3 doctors, and each one had a different discipline that they specialized in with healing. The first doctor was Dr. Danette Goodyear, who was a naturopathic doctor. Danette was trained in naturopathy, and I sat across from Danette for about 8 months every week for about 2 hours, and I berated Danette with endless questions, because I'm an extremely inquisitive person and I like to know and find out about things. I really like to figure out puzzles. I really like to figure things out. And Danette had answers when it came to natural biology. And so Danette, through her insight and through her work, which I'm going to explain in a minute here in regards to vibration, she was able to decipher for me a means to fight my cancer through the plant medicines, through energy, frequency, and to fight my cancer naturally without poisoning my body with something like chemotherapy or something like that. Okay, and then I also got an education from Danette about all kinds of biology, why I contracted cancer, how I was sick, why I was sick, what was the cause of the disease, which a Western medical doctor can't tell you. But Danette was very easily able to tell me. And one of the techniques that she used, and I'll tell you the other 2 doctors here in a minute, but one of the techniques that she used was for me to hold 2 brass bars which were tied into a computer. Now, all of us run on DC voltage. You're a DC voltage machine. Your heartbeat literally runs on a DC shock that your body generates, okay? And that constant shocking of voltage is what keeps you alive. Now you see it, now you don't. This is how everything works. And so you resonate. You're an electromagnetic creature. And so you resonate. You ring like a bell. Like the earth with its human resonance rings like a bell, you ring the same way. And you can ring your electromagnetics with a computer that can put voltage into you that rings at the quantum scale. Now, every single bacteria in you, every fungus, every pathogen, anything that's in you that is not you, that is trying to eat you and kill you, right, has a resonance. Just like a door. If you work at a door manufacturer and they make doors all day, every single one of those doors, when you knock on it, okay, when you knock on it, it's going to have a different resonation from every other door. And each door is going to have its own resonation. Just like if you, when you buy a guitar, every acoustic guitar sounds different. No two sound alike. It's because they all have their own resonating frequency based on the glue, the joints, the structure, the spacing, the resin, everything. It all contributes because everything's complex like that. All right. You have that same kind of complexity. And all of those pathogens in you resonate. And when you ring them with this machine, they vibrate. And the computer can pick up the vibrational waves that are in the electrical waves that come off of you through these bars that you're holding. And so Danette, without having to do any kind of invasive surgery, without having to do any kind of invasive work, with my just holding these two bars, you don't feel anything. You don't feel DC voltage passing through. This is all the quantum scale. And so she was able to fully diagnose me, tell me the viruses that I had, tell me all the pathogens that I had, everything that was pathogenic and corrupting my body, she was able to fully identify with her computer. And then she would go to the back room and she would find vessels filled with plant essences and oils, derivatives and compounds that come out of the immunosystems of a plant, because a plant has an immune system just like you. And it has compounds within it, just like you have compounds within you, that fight disease. And so when you identify the fungi, the bacteria and the pathogens that are in you, you find in the plant kingdom, the naturopathic doctor does, she finds the energies in nature that are contained in these liquids that will fight the energies in you that are killing you, the pathogens in you that are killing you. Because the plant's immune system resonates with your immune system because you're a nature creature. We're going to constantly be going back to that this whole time. You're a nature creature. And the sooner you identify that and begin to treat yourself with nature's medicines, the sooner you're going to heal. It's not rocket science. I'm not telling you something crazy and outlandish. I'm telling you something that coincides exactly with what Nikola Tesla was saying. Okay, and so that was one way that I was fighting my cancer. Another way was through Dr. Dickie Fuller, who unfortunately has now passed away. But Dickie, she was an enzymologist. You are not a cellular creature. You are an enzymatic creature. Your biology. Your biology is ruled and reigned and inspired through enzymes, probiotics. Okay, so enzymes, especially GST, glutathione S transferase, which is the enzyme that your liver produces every time you do a coffee enema, it increases 700% in your small intestine. Okay, glutathione S transferase is an enzyme that eats cancer cells, and you make it naturally. That's what they're doing at the Gerson therapy centers that they've shut down in the United States. That's what they're doing. They're using the coffee enema to fight cancer utilizing the glutathione S transferase enzyme that your body naturally produces. Okay, so I did that. That was one of the disciplines I did, and I took a bunch of enzymes, and then I also had a Chinese medicine doctor, Dr. Chen, and he worked with my chakras and through acupuncture, which is the harnessing of the electromagnetic energy that permeates all around you in the earth and on the earth and also round and about your body. And by sticking stainless steel pins into your body, you become like a magnet. You begin to absorb and bring in the healing energies that go through the meridians that are directly connected to your chakras. And you invigorate these things. And literally, in 20 minutes, Dr. Chen had me pain-free every single time I went to him. And the way you heal is being pain-free. You don't heal in the state of inflammation. And so he de-inflamed me with these pins that he stuck in my meridians, all in my body. What is this pointing back to? The Nikola Tesla quote here. If you want to find the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, frequency, and vibration. What are the pins doing in my body as I lay there in Dr. Chen, the Jedi Master, and he puts the pins into me? What am I doing? I am invigorating nature. I am invigorating my natural immunosystem, which works on energy, frequency, and vibration. What do you think the med beds are going to do? They're going to work in the principles of energy, frequency, and vibration. How do you think we're going to solve the energy crisis? through energy, frequency, and vibration, the ionosphere that's filled with static, endless electricity, static electricity. It's the same thing that UFOs run on. It's the same thing that caused the aurora borealis. Okay, my point here is, in all of this, all three of these doctors specialized in the disciplines of Nikola Tesla. I'm a cancer-free man, by the way. Okay, I'm 10, 11, 12 years post-cancer. And I'm healthy, as bird, healthy as can be. Okay. I say that to say, I found health. I found renewal. I found a way of living life pathogen-free by studying energy, frequency, and vibration. So if you're going to identify who you are, it would probably be a good idea to look to energy, frequency, and vibration as answers to that question. And that opens up our first slide as we walk into this. Who are you? And the reason why I'm asking this question right on the front end is because it is going to be the answer to that question I'm going to be pointing towards the rest of these lectures. And so to orient all of us to a similar mental rhythm, okay, I'm going to point to these questions and point to answers to those questions, and then you can you yourself evaluate your thoughts about that. And hopefully within that, we can find some common ground. Because the only way you're going to listen to me and the only way you're going to hear anything that I'm going to say today is if you identify with me at some level. I have to identify with you at some level, because if I don't identify with you at some level, everything I say is just going to go right in one ear and out the other. You won't hear a thing from me. Okay? And so I want to begin to answer some of these questions about identity, or not answer, but point towards some options in regards to the questions of identity by asking some questions or making some statements. Okay, your identity is consciousness, the God complex in you, known as the soul. Okay, you're not the body. The body is the carriage that carries the soul through life. Life is therefore an illusion. The material world is a product of your mind. You are in an illusion in the sense of the only thing you know is what is in your mind, and I can't hand my mind to you and you can't hand your mind to me. It's not real. It's not substantive. Okay? But the mind is the fire. The mind is what pierces all realms. It is what pierces the strata, the layers of reality that compose the reality. You get what I'm pointing at? You smell what I'm stepping in? Okay. Your soul is part and parcel of the reality, the huge reality, the ineffable reality. That's you. That's your identity. You're not the body. That's the point. You're the consciousness that invigorates, that brings about awareness within the body. Where in the body? In your mind. But your mind is not you. Your name is not you. Your religion is not you. Your beliefs are not you. Okay? You are past those ideas. You are past any idea. You see? Okay. So everything, when we talk about identity, it's always going to be less than. It's never going to quite equate. So the idea is to point towards concepts, notions, considerations that allow you access to cognizing in your mind who you are. Okay, but you're never going to be able to fully get your hands around it, just like you're never going to fully get your hands around the idea of God or ultimate awareness or any of that stuff. Physical birth offers awareness of the physical world, while mental death, kenosis, offers awareness of the spiritual world. The spiritual world is the real world. That's why I just said the world that you're in now is an illusion. It's the spiritual world that's the real world. This is what kenosis teaches you. Kenosis is to self-empty. This is to empty of the self-consuming ideas that you have about yourself and life and nature and God. The kenosis is that's what the cross represents. That's why Christ's head is at the point of contention, the point where the vertical intersects with the horizontal. That's the point of tension. And what part of you is at in within the point of tension, the mind. That's why Christ's head is on the cross at the point of contention. That's why Christ's mind is there, because that is what must die. What is causing the contention, which is the absorption, the belief in the illusory realm, which is the material world, that's causing the contention, that keeps the vertical from moving, stops it. Death of the self, kenosis, removes that problem. And you realize that the spiritual world is how you should be orienting yourself, not to the physical world. The physical world is the world of greed, the world of need, the world of clutching, the world of klesha. That's the physical world. The illusory maya that consume you, that cause inflammation, spiritual inflammation. Okay? So the kenosis is what is the cure for klesha, maya, the illusion of the world, the consuming of the world, the need for security, the need to fully understand, right? It's the wanting and desiring. It's the same idea that the Buddha talks about in enlightenment. The want and desire is occluded, is equated. And that happens through the process of enlightenment as well as kenosis. Kenosis is just the Western idea of enlightenment. The mind, which is the fire, is the sword that pierces layers of reality. That's the strata I was just talking about. And accords the soul through kenosis to self-empty, the abolishment of material concerns, which I just went over with the kenosis idea. The mind is the fire. This relates also to the tarot. The mind is the fire, is the sword that pierces reality. And the goal is to pierce these realities without fear of the fruits, the desire, the repercussions that happen as you pierce those realities. In other words, you go in benign. You go in allowing. It's the idea of the child's mind, the ball in the mountain stream. Thought to thought to thought to thought to thought to thought, no obstruction. This and entering into the Great Awakening, you must loosen yourself from the binds of material concerns. That when you have moored yourself to the shores of materialism, you will not be able to move into the shores of the Great Awakening, piercing that membrane, because you have locked yourself down at the shoreline. You're not leaving the boat and exploring up into the mountain to find the awakening, to find the higher heights, right? Because you're clinging to the boat that brought you there. And so the whole idea is the mind, which is the fire, must begin to burn. The fire is carries its own illumination. The mind carries its own fire. And the idea is to pierce these realities without any fear. And that's the goal. And the way you conquer fear is through knowledge, because it's what we do not understand and do not know that causes us fear. Okay? And so identity, if you're going to know who you are, you must have a sense of fearlessness. You must have a sense of courage. You must have a sense of quest, because it's something that never ends. Your identity, you will never fully grasp. And so it's a fire that burns inside of you, that is calling you, inspiring you. And this is how you find identity. That's why identity can't be told to you. It must burn out from within you, in the idea of the phoenix. You're burning out of death and into life. That's kenosis, the death of the self into the light, into life. It's that rebirth process that shows you who you are. Death is, oh my God, that's the next point. Death is the awakening process. That's how you know yourself. To know life, we accord death. So how do I really live? I quench the fear of death. This is what cancer did for me. Cancer was a gift for me. And it was a gift because it was the boat that carried me from the fear of death to no longer fearing death. It brought me to that shore where I no longer feared dying, because I realized it was just a transition of energies. It wasn't an end, because you can't make or destroy any energy in the universe, and you're a universal energy. You can never be destroyed. Okay, and so awakening to that is the key while you're still alive. That's why cancer was a gift. And while I'm still alive, I have the experience of death, of dying, the process of death, going to bed every single night for months and months and months on end, rejecting all of the doctors and their advice, holding to the advice of these other doctors centered in energy, frequency, and vibration, and every night going to sleep in peace enough to be able to sleep with the realization that I very well might be wrong. My pursuit might not be the path that leads to my health, and I accept that. I'm not going to be in fear of that. I'm not going to run from that. I'm going to walk into that space with confidence. You see, and cancer taught me how to do that by facing death every single night. I can't tell you how many nights I cried myself to sleep every night. I didn't know if I was going to be there in the morning for my kids, who were little at the time. Huge, enormous personal risk was put on the line for my being able to know this, to be able to share this with you. That's why my sharing with you, hopefully for a few of you, it communicates, because it cost me those things to find this out. I wouldn't know any of this stuff that I'm telling you, I promise you. Oh my goodness. I promise you, in the realms that I was in before I had cancer, I would not know any of this. I would not be able to accept any of this, because the bowl was full. My mind was full. It was full of religion. Religious ideas had filled my mind. And so nothing else could fit. And so it was through the metaphor of death that I was able to find life. Okay, the womb is a tomb because life is a preparation for death. This is a hermetic consideration here. To be born is the first step to death, which is in fact the door to awakening. Now see, womb and tomb have the same etymology. They come from the same root. So why is the womb a tomb? Because the womb is the first step to life, which is the first step to death. Because none of us are eternal, meaning the body. Our soul is eternal, but the body is not eternal. You will eventually die. I'm going to eventually die. Everyone's going to eventually die. And so the womb, when you're born and you come out of the womb, you are coming out of the tomb, which is the hearkening of what is to come. Your life is a metaphor, people. The sooner you understand that your life is a metaphor, that you are a symbol. You're not a reality. You're a symbol. You're a metaphor, just like the universe is a metaphor. The sooner you realize that, the less you will hold to certain opinions, because you will realize that your understanding comes from the metaphoric state. We're going to be talking about that here in a minute when we get into alchemy. Your identity, who you are, is not something that's going to come to you in words. It comes to you through alchemy. It comes to you through symbolism, through fearless participation, which means relinquishing that which you have always held. That's what it means. That's why it's so important to relinquish, to let go. The ball in the mountain stream, just like Alan Watts used to talk about. The phoenix, this harkens that same idea. The phoenix, life rising from death, symbolizes transmutation of the creative energy, which is the great work in alchemy. It is the creative energy which is your greatest asset, in my opinion. This is why we build empires. This is why human beings can build empires, because they have a creative faculty. It's why they can build skyscrapers. It's why they can build flying machines. Because some dude, some gal, was sitting in a chair one afternoon, or on a plane one afternoon, or sleeping one night or whatever, suddenly had this idea. What if we tried it this way? That's creativity. That's imagining the future. What can be done if I apply this science, this alchemy, this understanding, this vibration, this frequency? If I apply it correctly, I can create this incredible thing, okay? That is the creative force, and that is what you utilize to symbolize. Creativity helps you utilize symbology in such a way that you can experience the process of death and rebirth while in the conscious state. It is that contrasting, not conflict, that will show you who you are. This is why identifying through conflict, through say being a sinner is a bad idea because you are identifying through conflict. You're not identifying through contrast. Contrast is a higher level of thinking. It's not just looking at the north and south. It's noticing, hey, they're both on the same pole. It's a bigger reality. Even though they're opposites, they're connected. They're one. You see, that's a deeper perspective. And so through contrast, you are noticing the deeper perspective. Had you continued to look at just the north and south, you would never notice that they're one. Because you say, well, north can't be south, south can't be north. They're two different things. No, they're explicitly two different things. But that's an illusion. They're actually one. Okay, and your identity is the same way. You have both good and evil, positive and negative energy in you. Nothing's wrong. Here's the early warning of what's coming in part two. Nothing's wrong with you. Okay? Nothing has to be fixed. Everything has to be coalesced and amalgamated, equated. This is where the answer is found. Not banishing one and glorifying the other. Giving life to the iron chains that bind you to the material world while clinging to the golden chains of your good deeds and belief. You're tied down either way. You see, that's what's missed if you are caught up in a conflict-oriented reality, that one has to win over the other. And here we are, the last point. The great work is the transformation from material concern to spiritual identity. And really, that's what this whole set of statements has been about, is moving from your material concerns and world to the spiritual identity, which doesn't have concerns, which doesn't have conflict. It has understanding, it has knowledge, experience, epiphany. And so this transformation is the great work. That's what they were doing in alchemy. When you hear about them mixing different materials, ash and mercury and all these different oils and so forth to create a certain elixir. Okay, these are metaphors. These are metaphors. Alchemy is simply a metaphor for spiritual transformation. It's not necessarily that in a lab some scientist is mixing these things up, and by inventing gold from ash, he's done it. He's a good alchemist. That's not it. You've missed the point. It's a metaphor. Alchemy is a metaphor. And it uses real science, real metallurgy, and so forth. Absolutely real. But to help you see yourself in that metallurgical transformation. And that's the key in alchemy. Seeing yourself in the transformations, the physical transformations that you see in the metallurgy that you practice. Life doesn't have a destination. It's music. It's not getting anywhere. It's not going anywhere. It just simply is. It's a pattern. It's a reciprocation. It's an endless enigma that keeps transforming itself. And it has no point other than the constant transformation of itself. That is the point. The rebirth is the point. That's why there's nothing to fix. That's why there's actually no death, no life. It just isness. And death and life are just simply modes, layers of the strata that compose all of reality. Okay, from that, we then are ready to begin to study Hermeticism. Hermeticism is based on the study of observable patterns, ratios, habits, and reciprocations in nature, which could be mapped and delved to render a self-organizing force outside cognizance and experienced through patterns and emotions. Hermeticism is a science, a proto-science, that utilizes ancient observations, technology, understanding to understand not only the universe, but you yourself. Now, in that understanding is the idea that there is a self-organizing force that permeates all of the universe, that has no beginning, has no end. Outside words, my even talking about it and calling this force is or that is to blaspheme it, because that is belittling it. Hermeticism is a philosophy for the heretic, the alchemist, the cynic, the autodidact, and the doubter. That's what I love about Hermeticism. This is what I found out was. It's not a religion. Hermeticism is not a religion. It is a philosophy. It is a conversation. It's so much like Buddhism in that way. Buddhism is not a religion. It is a philosophy. It's a dialogue. It's a way of talking about yourself and the world. It's a certain context to put yourself into and the world into to understand it from another perspective. That's exactly what Buddhism is. That's exactly what Hermeticism is. These are philosophies. And a philosophy will work with you over time. It doesn't hold you down to a certain point. It doesn't moor you in and then you can never leave the harbor like a religion does. Hermeticism is like that. It's not going to moor you in. It's not going to tie you down. It's going to say, hey, here's some philosophies for you to consider. Here's some ways and some patterns that it would probably be a good idea to integrate into your own life because they really fit you well because you're a nature creature. And Hermeticism is full of nature. It's a nature science is what it is. As above, so below, an alchemical truth here. That as above, so below, this is a perfect opportunity to explain something that was turned evil. So you've seen the as above, so below. It's where they've got the two fingers up and the two fingers pointing down, or it's like this actually. When it's like this, right? And you've got the satanic symbol is you've got the two fingers up and the two fingers down. Okay. Satanism has taken this as above, so below, this beautiful concept, and has bastardized it and turned it into a satanic principle, and it's not. What as above, so below is telling you is that how the universe self-organizes above you is how it self-organizes in you. There's no evil going on here. This is not an evil principle. Okay, and the context that I'm giving it to you is the context that Hermetics wanted to give it to you, which is outside of this evil context. As above, so below. And the sooner you figure out that the way the heavens, the way the celestial realm is organized is the same way that you also are organized. The same way the heavens resonate, the same way the celestial realms resonate, the same way all the zodiacs, the signs, they each have their own resonation. In the same way they have their own resonation and their own frequency that they harmonize with, you also are the same way. You're the same way. And the beauty is that because you're creative, because you're an expressive emergent force, you can resonate at multiple layers. This is why a person can get caught up in addiction because they're resonating at a low frequency. This is why a person can get caught up in the spirit because they're resonating in a high frequency. You see, you can move between these different frequencies. So this alchemical truth, as above, so below, this is a hint. It's a hint. Hey, just so you know, the same way you resonate is the same way it all resonates up there. And when you begin to find that out, it's like, oh, well, then I can begin to see myself in the celestial realm. And that's the key. And when you begin to see yourself in the celestial realm, and you begin to see yourself as part and parcel with the resonations that surround you, well, then there's no alienation. There's no fear. There's no anxiety. You're aligning naturally. You see, so you can't be victimized because you realize your power. Because you realize the power you carry here is the same resonating power that ignites the sun, that glows the moon, that orients the constellations. Same. Okay, so here's some symbolism. Here, look at the bottom right. That's the rebus. That's the androgyne. Does that mean that their goal is to be both a male and a female? No, that's not what it means. That means that this person both understands the female and the male realms and the characteristics of those realms. And this person has mastered them. In other words, they can walk into these different male and female spaces and be fluent in that language, fluent in those metaphors, fluent in those energies, fluent in those resonations. That's what it's meaning. This is deeper thinking, folks. This is getting you out of the surface idea, which is, oh, well, look, it's both a male and a female. That's promoting trans. Come on. Come on. You have been dumbed down with these institutions that have coerced you into seeing the surface of things rather than the substance of things. And there is substance to these metaphors. Look at the one here on the left. That's calcination. You know what that means? Burning away the illusions of the mind. Is this here? Is this supposed to be portraying torturing people, putting them into ovens, gouging out their eyes, like right up there on the left there in the middle, gouging out their eyes, burning them? No, dude. No. No, don't look at this like a child would look at it. Look at it with your adult eyes and see what's really happening here. What is happening here? You see his hand, he's just waving to you, hey, how's it going? Everything's cool. My mind is just basically being destroyed, and that's part of the catastrophe. That's the Tower card in tarot. The catastrophe that's required for renewal. Death is required for renewal of life. This is a principle that's innate to you because as above, so below. The stars, they eventually die. They explode. They become a black hole, or they explode and become particulates, which then that dust then forms through the gravitational force and forms what? It forms a star again. There's the pattern. It keeps reciprocating itself. That's what nature does. Okay. This is the same process in you yourself. The exploding of a star is the same thing as the exploding of your mind and all the ideas in your mind being destroyed. All your religious ideas, all your medical ideas, all your scientific ideas, all the things that have been indoctrinated into you are destroyed in the fire. The fire that is renewal, the fire that is the death of the mind. This is why hallucinogenic plants are so important, because they facilitate the death of the mind, the pathways, the electric pathways that form the habits that cause you to have bad habits and behave in negative ways. And hallucinogenic plants, like the ones that healed me of cancer, are the same ones that can heal you of menticide, which are the patterns that have been put into you through indoctrination. Those have to be burned away, and through the pharmacology of nature, when looking to nature for answers, you can burn away those things in your mind that cause you to have bad habits, that cause you to do things that are self-destructive. Those are energies in you, folks. And plant medicines break apart those energies so that you can be renewed and you can think differently, think outside the patterns. And that's exactly what is being elucidated in this symbolism here of alchemy. And what you see this doctor doing here on the left here, prying open his eye, he is opening his mind. This is, that man represents nature and experience, painful experience, opening your eyes to a larger reality. That's what's happening. It's not actually a doctor prying and gouging your eyes out so now you can see. No, it's not that. It's a metaphor. These are metaphors. These are symbols. Nothing to be afraid of. It's not divination. It's not, you've been told it's divination. You've been told it's evil by people who don't want you to know these deeper principles. The controllers. That's why they handed you religion and handed you science and handed you medicine and handed you politics. That's why they did that, to dumb you down and keep you in those realms. You must break free of them. Kenosis, enlightenment, the letting go of material concerns, the letting go of what you have always known to be truth. That's why these symbolisms exist, to educate you, so that you can see yourself, meaning your identity, more deeply than what has been handed to you by the institutions who didn't want you to ever know this stuff. And I've come to find, actually, in the study, that this is the stuff they didn't want you to know. This is the stuff, Hermeticism, is the original material that the church went after. Eleusis, what was happening with the plant medicines, the Kikion, that they were taking. Everyone who was anyone was going to Eleusis, and they were experiencing this breaking down of the indoctrinations of what it means to grow up. Because in order to grow up, you have to align to certain laws, because you don't have the enlightenment yet to be able to navigate the world without those laws. But eventually you must loose from those laws, because those laws will continue to hold you down. But you have to do that appropriately by understanding the world in a larger sphere than what was handed to you as a child. That's why when you take what you learned as a child spiritually and you begin to try and utilize that as an adult, you're going to find some very, very bad habits begin to occur. And I'm not going to get into it, but there's a reason why there's an adolescent atmosphere that always accompanies an absolute religion. Always. Okay. Hermeticism, as I said earlier, is not a religion. It's a philosophy. It's an understanding of nature And within those gifts that you gather, understanding nature, you understand yourself better and you share those gifts with the world. Hermeticism helps you understand your gifts because it helps you understand that you are a nature creature based on energy, frequency, and vibration. That's what Hermeticism is doing. And it has been ostracized. It has been demonized by the church, by the ruling authorities, because they don't want you knowing this information. Because it will free you. It will liberate you from the institutions that you have been put into, the thinking institutions, the menticides that you have been put into, coerced into, by the societies that have ruled the world, like I talked about in the God Eaters. Those societies are what have put you into that menticide. And that's what all these symbols are trying to show you. And that's why it's so important that you learn symbolism, because it shows you who you are, because who you are can't be put into words. That's what Hermeticism is for, to help you identify who you are so that you see yourself past words. Because when you see yourself past words, you self-empower. You're not taken by words. You're not taken by threats, because you see past the surface of things. Okay, we got to keep moving on, or I'm going to be on this stuff forever. Hermeticism. Hermetic philosophy is the Prisca Theologia. Don't you love that word? The Prisca Theologia, formerly the Hermetic knowledge from the Western School of Egypt. Hermetic philosophy, Prisca Theologia, means ancient theology. You see? And so the Prisca Theologia is the ancient theology. This is the theology that predates the institutions. Remember how I said at the very beginning of this thing? The institutions that have lied to you. This technology, this philosophy, predates all of that. And so, this is that Western school that came out of Egypt. And as we all know, and as we learned from the last lecture in the God Eaters, Egypt was an inheritance. Egypt wasn't built by us as human beings. It was built before this incarnation of us was here. Meaning long, long before ancient Egypt, which they consider about 8,000 BC, 9,000, 10,000 BC, somewhere in there, maybe a little after. Way before that, 45,000 BC, 50,000 BC, something like that. Cliff High talks about it. That's where this knowledge comes from. That's where this is coming from. Ancient, ancient Egypt. Okay. The Prisca Theologia exemplifies Adolf Bastian's folk ideas for Western esoteric knowledge. Okay, and what I mean by that, what I mean when I write that is, Adolf Bastian, who is an anthropologist, he was very well-to-do at the turn of the century. Adolf Bastian traveled the world, and he found that all of these religions, all of these belief systems that permeate both the East and the West, all are focused on what he called the elementary idea, which is basically God, ultimate reality. And it was the folk ideas, the local provincial ideas that came out of the local folklore that described and costumed the elementary idea. So they're all, in other words, everybody's all talking about the same thing, but they have their own folk idea about it, their own costume, local costuming that they use for God. You see, and so how your concept of God is formed is through the local folklore, the local folk idea. And so if you were in Western Egypt during the Hellenistic age, this is the philosophy you would have learned had you gone to university. How about that? And so this way you are returning to the authentic. Remember I said at the beginning of the thing of the talk, I said that we're going to have an archaic revival. And we are returning back to the authentic. We're returning back to the true you, which is a nature creature who understands themselves through nature principles, through nature's theology, the Prisca Theologia. Now, where does Hermeticism come from? Well, it comes from Hermes. Hermes Trismegistus. You ever heard that name? Hermes Trismegistus. Who was Hermes? A Greek legendary figure like Buddha or Jesus. Okay? So this is a legendary figure. We're not sure if they lived or not. Okay? We're not absolutely sure, but they left a legacy. And just like Buddha and Jesus, Hermes left a legacy of knowledge, a legacy of perspective that if you study Hermeticism, you will begin to see the perspective that he was sharing, and this will widen your view. It will widen your world. It will make your philosophy, your ontology for life, much larger. And so you become more equalized and balanced as an individual because you are enriched with this amazing perspective that Hermes offers. He was a heralder of the gods, a messenger, okay? So what was one of Hermes' gifts? Was the gift of speech, the gift of writing, the gift of magic. Hermes was a cunning individual, could see past the surface of things. A cunning individual is able to see what a deceiver is attempting before the deceiver finishes what they're doing. And a cunning person says, wait a minute, I saw you here and there, and I saw you buy these things, and I saw you with that person. Okay, I'm beginning to understand you're not who you're portraying yourself to be. A cunning person sees through the lies. That's why it's a good idea to become friends with Hermes right now, because we all are filled with lies. And so if we're going to begin to see through those lies, it'd be a good idea to take on in your arsenal of philosophy philosophers who are really good at seeing past the lies. And that's something that Hermeticism does a great job of, is cutting past the BS. He authored the Emerald Tablet, which is a sacred registry of alchemy. You can look it up. There's too much to get into that also. Principal planet of influence is Mercury. Okay, Mercury, this is interesting. Mercury is the closest planet to the sun. The sun in ancient Hermeticism and proto-science was considered to be the bringer of all life. That's why the Romans called the sun of God. The sun, it illuminates, first of all, it illuminates the local planets and us, okay? So it allows us to see something. It's not just black void. So the sun provides light. It provides energy, namely electromagnetic energy, which is what we are and what the earth is, all the stars and everything. Everything is permeated by electromagnetics. And so the sun is an electromagnetic god in this sense. Not in the sense of it's God, not that sense, but it's a god in the sense of it has an incredible ability to bring about life, sustain life. It has an incredible ability to illuminate the local area and to shine amidst the darkness, okay? And so Mercury, the closest planet to the sun, is in the closest communication with the sun. So in Hermetic philosophy, all of the planets, the stars, all of these things are beings. They're alive. They have consciousness. It's just a different type of consciousness and a different type of existence than you. If you begin to force everything in the universe to have the same consciousness as you, to have the same existence as you, you're just belittling the universe to yourself. You're just an egotist at that point. Okay, so it's ridiculous to think, well, if the sun, the animals, whatever, don't have my consciousness, well, then they're not really there. They're not really as great as I am. That's ridiculous. That's hierarchy. You've been taught to think in hierarchical terms by bad institutions. Stop it. Okay, so the sun is conscious, and the sun communicates. Who does it communicate with first? Mercury. Mercury is the closest. Every 88 days, that planet has made another rotation around the sun, so it is in tune with the sun, Mercury is. It's very close to the resonant frequencies of the sun, so it is filled with the sun's energy. And so the principal planet of influence, having Mercury as your principal planet of influence, you're the closest planet to the sun. You're in greatest communication with the sun. You're in touch closer than the planets that are further away. Okay, and so Hermes was associated with Mercury. So Hermes was associated very closely with the sun, the provider of all life. So in other words, Hermes is a powerful figure, a powerful god. God in the sense of metaphor, in the sense of symbol, not in the sense of actual God walking on the earth, giving commands and forcing people to do things. No, dude, no. Get outside of that. That's an elementary idea of a god. You're gonna have to think, I might as well go into it now. You're gonna have to think in the terms of all the gods and goddesses from Olympus, all the lords and ladies from King Arthur, all of the parables, the people in the parables, and the to what Christ was pointing to in his parables. All the stories of the Buddha and what he experienced with the people, the beggars, the dying people that he experienced as he was became aware and awakened. All of these principles, God's energies, are you. They're you because those potentials are in you. And so when you see gods referred to in Europe, in the Middle Ages, and so forth, those were all intended originally to be referring to the principles within you, the characteristics you carry as an impossibly beautiful human being. Okay, Hermes is the Hellenistic conflation of the Greek god Hermes and the Egyptian god Thoth. Now, I was going to open up a huge ball of wax in regards to Thoth, but it extended this first video out to over 3 hours. And so I couldn't, there's no possible way to do that. And so what I have done is I'm going to have to skip over that, and I'm just going to go straight to these points here that I've written out about Hermeticism to orient us to Hermeticism as quickly as possible. Hermeticism is a nature philosophy which accords the spiritual and material aspects of the experienced universe, okay? So like I said earlier, Hermeticism grounds you in actual experience and reality. It doesn't require you to have this huge imagination and imagine the spiritual being and imagine the spiritual force. No, it says, look at the patterns that the spiritual force leaves, namely sacred geometry. Look at how things grow and notice the similarities between how a tree grows and how you grow. Notice the similarities of the electromagnetic force and pattern of the earth, how similar it is to the electromagnetic pattern that is also encompassing you. The philosophy of nature's pattern. Rupert Sheldrake liked to call it habits. Nature has habits. And the habits of nature is nature revealing to you its philosophy. And so when you pick up on the habits, you pick up on the patterns, you pick up on the underlying truth that is permeating in nature, that also therefore is permeating in you because you're a nature creature. Hermeticism is a spiritual proto-science which elucidates patterns observed in nature into a spiritual alchemy that fosters awareness and appreciation. That's something that I found out doing this, as I've been studying all this stuff, is that it has been fostering in me an awareness and appreciation of myself which I've never had. Because I never realized how much of an electromagnetic being I am and what that implicates. I never realized it. I never realized how electromagnetism is the magnating force that holds the entire universe together. The more deeply I understand myself and the universe, the more I will appreciate the universe. Well, what happens when I appreciate something? I begin to love it. I begin to respect it. And I can't choose love any more than I can choose respect. Those come out of me by what I experience, by what I observe. Pure inspiration is what I'm pointing towards here. Hermeticism is a proto-science that inspires. It inspires a spiritual alchemy within you that fosters awareness. Why? Because you begin to learn the world as it naturally is, as a nature creature. And this fosters appreciation, which then fosters love, which then fosters respect. If you want to treat the world and love the world in a way that you never have, learn about it. Understand and know it outside the institutions that are trying to tell you what it is. You see, Hermeticism will have a conversation with you on that level that will allow you to grow and expand as the universe grows and expands. That's why it's such blasphemy that they're trying to hold science down, saying that the speed of light never changes. By doing that, that's blasphemy because the speed of light does change. Rupert Sheldrake has shown that repeatedly. Okay, and science is always trying to pin it down in the same with the material world, in the same way religion is always trying to pin down the spiritual world. Absolutes. And this is inappropriate. You will not learn doing that. That's like saying I'm going to go learn to sail by mooring myself to shore. You're not going to learn to sail doing that. You got to get out and sail, right? Hermeticism, in this way, Hermeticism is a holy science. Get it? science in that it is not a religion or belief system. It is a philosophy, like I just emphasized. Hermeticism contains rich Egyptian and Arabic ancient knowledge and proto-science from ages of humanity, which predate the Younger Dryas. That means it's clean, baby. That means it hasn't been tainted by the Catholic Church. It hasn't been tainted by science, the scientific church. It hasn't been tainted by the medical church, you see. It hasn't been tainted by the political church, you see. By the life is a war church, you see. It's a proto-science. It predates all those concerns and harkens back to this nature orientation. Hermeticism dates from the Hellenistic Age, 323 to 31 BC, the age of the cynics, stoics, doubters, and the unconvinced. This is during the time of Plato, Aristotle, and Socrates. This is why McKenna would always talk about the Hellenistic philosophers. It's because this is during an age, and I'll show you in this next slide here, this is during an age when reason was still acceptable. Read here that I found, the Hellenistic world was the great golden age of Athenian philosophy, encompassing Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. It had only lasted for about 100 years. Think of that. It's like a flame, just poof. It was there and gone. Now you see it, now you don't. In the centuries that followed, changes in the political and cultural climate of the ancient world tended to discourage many varieties of philosophical thinking, you see. They began to shut it down. Remember when I said earlier that the church went out and destroyed the institutions that were teaching this stuff? Okay. They don't want to have philosophical thinking. Controlling institutions don't want you thinking for yourself, and they don't want to be questioned. They want their statements as absolute. You don't question. You obey. You see? And this entire, the Hellenistic world, the whole thing was about doubting. The whole thing was about cynicism. The whole thing was about philosophy. And so that's a threat. That is a threat to institutions. That is a threat to control. Because a person who thinks for themselves can't be controlled because they're making their own decisions. And so those decisions won't always align to what the controllers want. And so the way you quench a person from thinking for themselves is you lock them into a cage of thought, which is religion, which is science, and saying, do not exit any of the bounds that have been set for you, because they've been set for you for your own good. Because if you leave those bounds, well, you're in trouble. If you don't believe like this, you're in trouble. You see, and that locks you in. And so you're like, okay, I'm not gonna ever leave these bounds. I'm gonna follow all of these authorities and what they're saying to me, the orthodoxy. I'm just gonna stay locked in that, and I'm not gonna question it. Do not question the Western God. Do not question if you're a climate destroyer. Don't question that. Don't question if the earth is getting hotter or getting colder. We will tell you. We will tell you. We will tell you what God is and when God is coming back. We will tell you, and we will tell you why and how to know God. You see, these are controlling institutions. And this time, this Hellenistic age, is anti that. And this is why exactly you see right around 325 AD, this is why you see the stopping of that. Put a halt to these free thinkers, right? These cynics. One of the key points of ancient Greek philosophy was the role of reason and inquiry. It emphasized logic and championed the idea of impartial, rational observation of the natural world. You see, so Hermeticism is a way out. Hermeticism links, and here, now we're going to start getting into it. Hermeticism links Platonic solids with the golden ratio and applies them to an everyday observed proto-scientific nature world effectuated in the universe of the everyday human being. These are the heroes of this. Socrates from 470 to 399 BC, Plato from 427 to 347 BC, and Aristotle 384 to 322 BC. These are the heroes of Hermetic philosophy. These are the heroes of Platonic solids. And did you know Platonic solids, we're going to get into that here. Let's go to the next slide. Platonic solids are what are going to orient you to understanding yourself through the idea of God, through the idea of ultimate reality, because Platonic solids contain the universal language, which is mathematics, which describe the processes of the vortice. And as we know, the vortice is a fractal. And so Platonic solids contain a 3D visual imagery of the mathematics, the calculus, that forms the universe. Okay? And so this first, let's look at these closely. Plato was a Hermetic philosopher and taught our reality was based on nested Platonic solids, which through the maths of polygons define the characteristics of light when it is bent or influenced by electromagnetism. Okay? So Platonic solids, and we'll show them here in a minute, but Platonic solids are 3D images, and the angles that the images form contain the calculus, the math, the geometry that forms the Fibonacci sequence, that forms sacred geometry. It's the underlying language of these aspects of nature, these habits of nature, namely the Fibonacci sequence and pi, the fine structure constant, these patterns of nature which build the universe. The universe comes out of these patterns. The self-organizing chaos is organized through this language, this mathematical language, and that is represented in the nested Platonic solids. That's why Plato said what he said. That's why he said everything can be described within the nested Platonic solids. This is what he is pointing towards. And I'm trying to orient you that in understanding this also is your orientation. Because the mathematics which compose our galaxy, the Milky Way, the sun, the physics of the sun and so forth, is the same mathematics that compose you, that compose the tree, that compose the earth. The Fibonacci sequence, pi, the fine structure constant. This is the realm that will identify you so that you can know the language that you naturally speak. Nested Platonic solids are multifaceted polygons whose maths coincide with the layering, ratios, and patterns observed in nature. We see these maths expressed in phenomena from the Fibonacci sequence to tree proportion to the bending of light, vortex geometry, or the infinity of fractals. Now, I've got videos for this stuff, and I'm going to be revealing them to you over the next four lectures. But what I wanted to communicate was that, like I mentioned earlier, this Fibonacci sequence, tree proportion, the bending of light, electromagnetics, have a common denominator. And that common denominator is the math, the language that composes nested Platonic solids. And I'm kind of repeating here because I know these are heavy ideas that are new. Because when someone says, what's a nested Platonic solid, most people have no idea and wouldn't even really want to know. But you see, this is how you self-organize, finding these things out, which help you define yourself past ideas of conflict and identify yourself through ideas of contrast. You see? Plato taught it was from these nested patterns the material universe manifests from the ether. Remember, the ether is the fifth element. We'll get to that. These shapes carry the mathematical and spiritual ethos that transmutes spirit into matter. Stop right there. It is this mathematics, this fractal mathematics, that coalesces the ethereal realm, the ethereal strata, into the material realm, the material strata. This is the language that is used. It's a concept that you're not going to be able to write down. This is the language that is used. Math is the universal language, and it is the language that is used to transmute the ethereal into the material. And we have a whole talk on that. But that's what the Platonic solids are pointing towards. That's why it's such a big deal. Nested polygons give substance to light by relating it to the equations, resonances, and patterns that build time and space. Without light, there's no time and space. We'll find out more about that in the electromagnetic study we do in part two. But this is why Plato emphasized the need to understand nested Platonic solids. And so this next slide, this is the one before I'm going to show you some videos. Platonic solids are mathematical ratios expressed in 3D polygons. And here they are on the right here. The polygon angles render the calculus that underpins the self-organizing vortices, length ratios, and number patterns that structure the universe. Nature self-organizes in consistent mathematical equations like the Fibonacci sequence, golden ratio, or fine structure constant. And Platonic solids render those mathematical sequences in 3D form. This is why Tesla said 3, 6, and 9 undergird the universe. It is because the calculus of the polygons reduced to set patterns that fold into the numbers 3, 6, and especially 9. And I'm going to show you that all that in video because I know that's a heavy statement. But just continue to read as you begin to grasp this concept. Nested Platonic solids. All Platonic solids nest within each other. Remember, they are not five separate shapes, but five aspects of the same shape, the same spinning sphere torus. When one Platonic solid is present, they all are present. They cannot be separated. You see, this is language. When one form of the language is present, the language is present. It's like when you see a sentence, when you see certain symbols, which are the letters, the language is present because the symbols are there, are present on the paper, and you can read them. You see, they form the language, the understanding. And in the same way, putting the letters together form a sentence, which form a concept to you. It's the same exact idea. These are the sentences of the structure that undergirds the universe. That's what these are. These are sentences. And these sentences form within each other a structure, like a paragraph or a book, that then informs you, this is what builds the universe. In the same way a book will build an idea in your mind, the Platonic solids will build the math, will build the language, the symbolism in your mind to understand yourself and the universe better. That's the point of them. That's why the funny thing is they're so simple, yet they're also so complex, because their symbolism, what they represent, is very deep. That's why it's important. That's why symbolism is so important, because it's like looking at a painting. It shows you 1,000 words in one glance, and these nested Platonic solids show you 1,000 perspectives of the universe in one glance. In just one look, you begin to see, oh, this is what composes me. This is the language. This is the mathematics. This is the structure constant, the fine structure constant that forms me. Okay, let's look at the Platonic solids in this video, and then we'll also talk about, we'll show the vortex mathematics, which is the mathematics that forms the universe that Tesla talked about. Do you see how all of the polygons fit within each other? See how they fit in there? Line for line. And they're super complex, but yet they fit right together. It's like a miracle. It's like looking at a miracle. Like, you would never imagine in your mind that those shapes would perfectly fit into each other, but yet you see here, they do perfectly fit into each other. And this then shows you in 3D, this is the math. This is the language of the universe speaking to you as you look at these. These are the sentences that compose the universe, the symbols, the statements that compose the universe.
Nikola Tesla, the greatest mind of all the time and also a man of mysteries, said that if you knew the magnificence of 3, 6, and 9, you would have a key to the universe. So what did he mean by this? Had he found some code of the universe? Our universe is so mathematical. Almost everything in nature is highly symmetrical and follows geometrical patterns. We can see these patterns in the form of golden ratio and Fibonacci sequence present in many things in the nature. Everything is made up of particles, and if we go deeper at even more microscopic level, we reach into the quantum world, which is pure mathematics. All the living things in this world are made up of cells. Multicellular organisms are formed by the division of a single cell. A single cell divides into two cells, then after division of both the cells, we get four cells, then 8, 16, 32, 64, and 128 cells are produced. In this way, the doubling sequence continues, and finally, we have a full multicellular organism. Now let's try to understand the sequence mathematically. You can see here is a sequence of doubling of numbers starting from number 1, like 1, 2, 4, 8, and so on. Here the next number is double of the previous number. Now we will convert all of these numbers into a single digit number. For this, we will add the digits of the number until we get a single digit number. This final single digit is called the digital root of the number. So here you can see the digital roots of these numbers. Now observe the digital roots shown in orange color. Can you observe a pattern here? You will see a repeated sequence of numbers 1, 2, 4, 8, 7, 5. Even if you repeat it up to infinity, the same pattern repeats. Now, instead of doubling the numbers, let's halve the numbers repeatedly. This time also, we will start with number 1. Add all the digits of the number and get the digital root as shown here. You will be surprised to see that this time too, we get the same numbers repeatedly that we got in case of doubling the numbers. So in both the cases of doubling and halving the numbers, we are getting the same numbers 1, 2, 4, 8, 7, and 5. Did you notice one amazing thing here? In both the sequences, numbers 3, 6, and 9 are missing every time. In the diagram, these repeating numbers 1, 2, 4, 8, 7, and 5 are shown in a white color. And the numbers that are missing in the sequence every time, that is 3, 6, and 9, are shown by yellow color. But what does the absence of numbers 3, 6, and 9 in the sequence mean? According to some researchers, numbers 1, 2, 4, 8, 7, and 5 represent our three-dimensional world where we live in. An absence of numbers 3, 6, and 9 in the sequence means these numbers belong to a higher dimensional world. But what will happen if we double or halve the numbers starting from number 3 or 6? Let's double the numbers starting from number 3. On doubling the previous number, we get the next number. Now find the digital roots of the numbers. You will be surprised after seeing the results. We will get only two numbers, 3 and 6, every time. Notice all the numbers that were present in the previous sequence are absent this time. And numbers 3 and 6 were completely absent in the previous sequences. Okay, let's do some more maths. This time, we will halve the numbers repeatedly starting from number 3. Here are the numbers. Now again, get the digital roots of the numbers by adding the digits of the number. And here is what we get. Amazing! This time also, we get the same numbers 3 and 6. Hence, whether we double or halve the numbers, if we start with number 3, we get numbers 3 and 6 only. Even if we double or halve the numbers starting from number 6, we will get the same numbers 3 and 6 every time. But surprisingly, even this time, 9 is absent in the sequence. Actually, number 9 controls the numbers 3 and 6. And numbers 1, 2, 4 are controlled by number 3, while numbers 8, 7, and 5 are controlled by number 6. In this way, number 9 controls all the numbers. You will get incredible results when we start doubling and halving the numbers from number 9. We are getting only a single number, number 9. What will happen if we halve the numbers repeatedly starting from number 9? What do you see? We are getting number 9 every time. No other number is present in the sequence. Even on adding the digits in the table of 9, we get number 9 only. So we see whether we double or halve the numbers starting from number 9, we always get the number 9 only. It implies that number 9 represents itself.
Okay, so I'm gonna walk with you through this. Now what you're seeing is the common denominator of 9. So as the digital roots of these angles is shown, what you see is constantly refers back to 9. And as you continue to divide the circle, a singularity forms, the void. Okay, this is showing you through math and geometry how the rest of the universe manifests. And it's all based in this vortex mathematics. Okay, and so what they're going to show you here is the polygons that are on the platonic solids we've been talking about. All right, these are the angles, the digital roots of the angles that are on the polygons, that form the polygons. And so when the digital roots are found for these angles, they also equate to 9. And so it doesn't matter if you're working with circles or polygons, you have the same common denominator, which is 9. This is the hidden mathematics, the hidden language that Tesla was referring to. And all of these are resonating like a north and south pole resonate together to form a single magnet, to form a single pole. And so in the same way, all these shapes and the circles all form two, conclude to the same number, 9. So it's just like the pole, where north and south conclude at the same point on the pole, meaning the pole itself. You see, this gives it meaning. It's the same way with the geometry. They're all equating to 9. You see? There's the singularity. That's the void. That's talked about in Eastern mysticism. The beginning and end. This is how nature, the universe, communicates to you. It's not in a language that you speak. It's in a language that you see. And here again, we see the measures of the cosmos. The time and space of the cosmos also equates back to 9. And if you take the time to notice this, you see yourself in the universe, because you also have and carry this same ratio geometry, which equates to 9.
Science relates the maths of polygons to 3D shapes and forms. Okay, so your mind, you see here, science has related these polygons into 3D shapes, and you can see them here with your mind, with your sight. You see them. So this is your mind at work seeing the shapes. Alchemy, right? Alchemy, which is a transformative discipline, relates the 3D form resonances to like energies in nature. This is the work of the body. So this is relating the alchemy, the science, the math, the language to you yourself, to what you experience in the here and now world. In other words, the resonances that are contained in the mathematics, in other words, these shapes, is the same resonances that you find in nature. So this tetrahedron is the same resonating frequency, resonating mathematics that is fire, that represents fire, the illusion of fire, the material world of fire, right? In the same way, the octahedron is the mathematics that composes the resonation of the air. Just like when Danette hooked me up with those bars to the quantum field and the resonances of the bacteria that was in me, that was eating me, had a name, had an identity, and had a form that came out of simply its vibration. It's the same thing here. This form that you see with your mind is being related to your experience. Fire, air, earth, water, the ether. These relate you. This is how you relate from the platonic, the nested platonic solids. This is how you relate that to you yourself through resonation. What did I say? Everything is based on in this lecture from the stuff from Tesla. Energy, resonation, frequency. And that is what's happening here. Hermeticism then relates resonance to the spiritual relationship. Hermeticism will be the carriage that carries you from this resonating understanding and experience into the spiritual relationship through symbolism. That's why Hermeticism, like we showed earlier, has all of the symbolism that goes with it. It's because it is through the symbolism that you recognize your spiritual layers, your spiritual aspect.
And that is what the point of this lecture is to orient you to this. Okay, now looking at the golden ratio, this is the map, this is the pattern of nature, this is nature speaking in language to you. The golden ratio is irrational, right? So nature's chaotic, is it not? Is space not chaotic and crazy? Is it not? But it also has an organizing to it. It also has an organizing that you can recognize and see. When you look at that spiraling galaxy, you're like, you know what? That's an organized sphere I'm looking at there. You know, I'm seeing a pattern here. There's an organizing going on. And what you see when you look at that galaxy and those spinning legs of the galaxy and the arms and so forth that you see happening, you're looking at the golden ratio. Just like when you look at the polygons of the platonic solids, you're looking at the golden ratio. This relates you. The golden ratio here, and I've got a little example here where I show, the golden ratio is a ratio of lengths. That's what the ratio is. It's a ratio of lengths, and it's irrational. How deep does the vortex go of a black hole? It's infinite. Okay, that's vortex geometry like you just learned in that video. Okay, this is vortex geometry when it comes to ratios of lengths. Okay, and so by looking at this, you then begin to see that this is an organizing pattern. And what you then can take from that is, look at how trees grow. Look at how you grow. Look at the ratio of lengths and proportions that you have that are also in nature. It's the same ratio. This is the ether manifesting, because the ether, the chaos, manifests in an organized mathematics. And we you see it. That manifesting of that mathematics you're seeing here in all of these shapes. Spiral shape, the human body, the root structure, the branching structure, the arm length, the arm sections. These all are related, and they're related through this Fibonacci sequence, the platonic solids. Although trees and bushes differ in shape, their ratio of length to width is close to the golden section. In some plant stems, the divergence of angle between the two adjacent leaves approximates 137 degrees, 137.28 degrees. This is the central angle forming two radii. And if we divide the circumference into two parts, the ratio is 1 to 0.0618. The 137.5 is the fine structure constant. And again, we see the math permeating. This is the language of nature, permeating all of language. The word became flesh, the word became material matter. This is that language. That's what that metaphor is referring you to. This is the language of nature, and it is found here in Hermeticism. This golden ratio, the wavelengths and resonances that we have in the polygons, remember, they also align to your chakras. And this scientist found that the wavelengths matches the length ratio of the Fibonacci sequence. So even the location of the chakras in your body follow the ratios of the Fibonacci sequence of pi. Okay, that's not chance, folks. That doesn't just happen. Because that same ratio is the same ratio that forms a galaxy. The pinwheel, the lengths of the legs, and the spread of the legs in the pinwheel of a galaxy is the same exact ratio and spread of space that happens in the chakra system. And look, this person even found it didn't matter the person's size, because your ratio always is the same as an adult. It doesn't change. The ratios of the chakra follow the size of the body, which follows the Fibonacci sequence. And then those... The colors of the wave, they align acoustically. So the acoustical spectrum also divides up in the same ratio mathematics. And this is simply to show you, folks, this is the self-organizing force at work. This is how from chaos we get organizing. This is how from darkness we get light. Do you see the metaphor? From darkness comes light, which returns back to darkness, which becomes light. And that endless pattern is what forms the universe, forms the material world. A pattern universe. We are fractals. We make more babies that make more babies that make more babies. You ever notice that?
That's a fractal action, and we do it naturally. It's just a part of us. Civilizations are fractals. They build, grow, destroy themselves, then rebuild, grow, destroy themselves, then rebuild. How many times has society rebuilt itself? You know this. You see the history buried in the ground. There has been a rebuilding taking place, even though it has been run by dark forces. That rebuilding process is part and parcel to nature, because from death comes life. That's why where the carcass rots on the ground, where the blood is spilt, the grass will grow greenest, because from death comes life. It is the transforming of energy that is life. You see, that's why your participation is so important, because you transform the energy about you and within yourself when you participate. You see? Trees are fractals. Trees make more seeds that make more trees that make more seeds. You see? It's just like Dr. Seldrake talks about, habits. Nature has habits, and she loves to exploit those habits. She loves to play within those habits. She likes that. And then within those habits, from repeating that same phrase over and over again, an anomaly occurs. And this also is extremely attractive, because we love the eccentric. We love the individual that's unique. It's the fumbliness and clumsiness of the baby that makes the baby adorable. Because most people aren't like that, but a baby is, and a baby doesn't apologize for it. And that's what makes it so adorable and beautiful. You see, and that's what we do as human beings. We bring about, we tease out life in the universe, just like a tree teases out seeds. Forests are fractals. They sprout, grow, densify, burn down, sprout, grow, densify. See the pattern again. Patterns, it never stops. Stars are fractals. They condense, shine, explode, recondense, shine, explode. It never stops. It never stops. And the sooner you coalesce with that, the less you fear death, because you realize it's just another transformation. It's just a transformation of energy from one type of energy in existence to another. Don't make it a big deal. It doesn't need to be a big deal. That's why laughter is the greatest medicine, because it levels you. Because you're not to take life seriously, you take it sincerely. Studying Hermeticism, studying these disciplines is saying, I want to take life sincerely. It's not a joke. But at the same time, I don't want to take it too seriously. I don't want to take it seriously, just like I don't want to take myself seriously, right? Because if I take myself seriously, I get caught up in myself, in my concerns, and in anxiety, right? Okay, so the whole idea is, again, the thought to thought to thought to thought to thought to thought with no obstruction. Life to life to life to life, life to death to life to death to life to death with no obstruction. You see, it's all the same patterns, and we just coalesce with that. Now, speaking of vibration, patterned universe, as we see here in this snowflake, do you see how the water forms its own structure like fire forms its own light? Do you notice that as the water freezes, it forms its own spectacular pattern. And then look how the seeds are nested in the sunflower. That's the most efficient and effective way of storing those seeds, of bringing those seeds possible. It's because nature is the most efficient force in the universe. And so, of course, when nature organizes, when it self-organizes, it's going to self-organize in the most efficient manner. Right? And we see this here in the pattern universe. You ever seen cymatics? I'm going to show you here a video. But here you see nature self-organizing into patterns. These reflect sacred geometry. What you see on the right here is plasma. And in the same way, acoustical energy forms the sand into patterns, electrical energy forms the plasma into patterns. It's because nature repeats in habits. It's habitual. And nature repeats in these patterns, and they're novel to look at, because you cannot believe that from the chaos, something like this, something so organized and beautiful, can come out. But that's exactly what happens. That's a description of you. That's a perfect description of you. From chaos comes you, this perfectly beautiful representation of nature without any faults. The idea that you're faulted, the idea that you taint, the idea that you're evil, the idea that you're bound to be a destructive force. These are controlling agencies to program you to think that way about yourself. They're lies. You're just like the sand on top of the table. Just put some frequency into it, and it self-organizes. You're the same way. Just self-identify. Know who you are. go through the process of kenosis, like releasing from the material world, and you resonate just like the sand resonates, and the glory will come out of you. The art will come out of you. The gifts will come out of you because you will be acting from the space of inspiration rather than terror. Fear is a way of getting you to have motivation, motivate you to action, because there's only two ways to motivate a person to action, like Dr. Campbell taught, which is through fear or terror and through inspiration. It's the only two ways you can motivate a human being. Hermeticism works to inspire you through self-identity. You see, religion and science works to put you into a cage, put you into fear, put you into a set. And from that, you motivate out. In other words, from the compression, you then motivate out rather than from expression, rather than from emanation. From within, out comes the beauty. You see, because when you see yourself as a dirty carbon generator, see yourself as a sinner, it's only dirt that's going to come out. You see, you got to stuff in their goodness, and then it's okay. You see, that's working with a problem. That's what you can learn from these patterns that you see in nature. Nature operates where you just simply tease out in the proper energy, frequency, and vibration, and the self-organizing self becomes. That's why when you take plant medicines, you tease out the self-organizing characteristics that are already within you, and you can heal yourself from disease. Because the plants are resonating you like electricity is resonating this plasma, or the acoustics are resonating that sand. And you heal through resonating forces. That's why that stuff works. And we can also see it in the snowflakes. And here's a video on cymatics in case you've never seen it. And you can see how this self-organizing structure works. Okay, now Chuck, you ask, why are you bringing up tarot right next to cymatics and plasma and the platonic solids? That doesn't make any sense. Okay, I understand that doesn't make sense. But what you need to understand is, what people don't know is that the tarot, the major arcana, represents all the human emotions. Did you know that? And these emotions within you have resonant frequencies, just like the chakras have resonant frequencies. And the good thing is that the tarot shows you what those resonating frequencies represent in symbolism. Symbolism speaks to your mind. In other words, tarot transduces the energy of the universe into a symbol that you can cognize in your mind to help you understand yourself better. Because the better you understand your feelings and emotions, which are what these cards are describing, the better you will know yourself. And the better you know yourself, the less afraid of yourself you will be, and the more self-empowered you will become. Because that's a scale. As fear goes down, self-empowerment goes up. It's a sliding scale. As fear goes up, self-empowerment goes down. You can't change that. That's the law of the universe. Okay? And so the idea is to equalize, to come into harmony with your negative parts, your dastardly parts, the parts of you that would do evil things, right? The idea is to take that energy, not throw it away, but take that energy and utilize it constructively. Utilize it in such a way. For example, let's say like you have a tremendous amount of energy to fight and you love fighting and you want to fight others and you feel a great sense of conflict and you want to carry this out. Let's say you were abused or something as a child and so you have this tremendous tendency to fight. Well, then take up boxing. Take up special forces. Take up disciplines that will utilize that force within you, harness it and channel it and exert it in such a way that's healthy, in such a way that will benefit you. You don't want to get rid of it. That's good to have a fighting spirit. That's a great quality to have. But you've got to harness it and direct it in such a way that you don't destroy yourself with it. You see? That's the purpose of tarot. It was never meant for divination. It was never meant to be blasphemed like that. It was simply there to help you through symbolism understand yourself better and relate yourself better with the universe, because it uses universal principles. It utilizes the celestial realm to help orient the cards to speak to you. And we'll get into that. But the point I wanted to make here, and this is why I have them together here in this picture, the resonations that are in those cards are the same as the resonations that you see in this photo on the right. You're just seeing it in symbolistic form rather than electrical form, rather than acoustical form. Now you're seeing it in symbolistic form. And it is important for you to relate these things. And all of them refer and relate back to the resonations found in the Platonic solids. You see how all of these things are related? This is how you then are related. This is how you relate yourself in a very real, tangible, sensible sense without having to believe in all kinds of crazy stuff, right? Grounding yourself in reality, you then begin to understand yourself from that perspective. And that's why I've put these together, so you begin to see these are assets available to you, folks. They are assets that have been tainted to keep you from looking at them and learning from them. They have been blasphemed, plagiarized, and used against you to keep you down. Honestly. That's why the tarot was demonized. That's why it was used for means of divination. Because it's the energy they carry is real. And energy can be used in good ways and bad ways. Just like the fighter, it can be used in a good way to win battles. It can be used in bad ways to destroy himself, him or herself. And it's the same thing with this. The universe is energy, and it can be used in both ways. And so you were put into these ideas of negativity as though all of the universe is a battle against itself. That the dark is going to win if the white doesn't fight. You see? And so these were meant to equate you, not put you into conflict. And so by seeing the contrasts that are within the cards, you then begin to see the contrasts that are in yourself, that are the patterns, the behavioral patterns, that are just like the contrast and the patterns that you see in these figures on the right, in the plasma and in the cymatics. Do you see that? This is all related to energy, frequency, and vibration. This all comes from Nikola Tesla. This all is related. I am using nothing but energy and frequency and vibration for you to understand these things. And let's finish up here with what I think is the most beautiful metaphor in the talk. Experience is the music of God. Matter is music solidified. Do you see that? Just as notes on a scale symbolize a corresponding frequency of an instrument and its tone, so also constellations in the sky represent corresponding frequencies, resonations, and instruments of the universe. Our birth is a song of the universe. When we are conceived, form, and exit the womb. And I'm going to get into that. I'm going to get into that in the next lecture. I'm not going to start now, but I'm going to open that up for you so that you understand what that statement means. These events matter as they shape your characteristics. I can't wait to tell you about that. At birth, the frequencies, the vibrations, the echoes of the resonating universe that permeate the earth also permeate us. Iron resonates iron. The blood in your body is filled with the same iron that fills this planet. Our mortal experience is the music of the Godhead, the enigma, the impossibility, the unspeakable transmogrified to life by a star. And we're going to get into that in the next one. The point I wanted to make in this is when you see constellations in the sky, it's just like seeing an orchestra. Each constellation has its own representation, symbols, and resonations that go with it, energies that are a part of it, okay? And in the same way, when you look at an orchestra, each instrument has its own resonating frequency, its own specialties. Some are low, some are high, some are in the middle. Some are boom and banging, some are very quiet and mellow. Some are percussive, some are smooth, okay? They all have their own unique characteristics. Each one is beautiful. And it's the same thing with the constellations. This is going to help quench your fear of looking into the constellations for understanding of yourself. Each one has its own unique beauty. And if you begin to see it as simply an instrument in an orchestra called the cosmos, you then will begin to quench your fear and you'll begin to see the patterns, because you'll notice that there are planets that follow certain energies. Jupiter is in Sagittarius and Pisces. These resonate together like a sea anemone and a little clownfish. They each one are better off with the other. They each one resonate with the other. They utilize each other to create a greater energy and force. And that's exactly what is happening with the planets and the stars, folks. They are related. Santo Spinacci communicated in one of his lectures that the Sirius star, the dog star, the two oscillating stars that are so far away, right? At one point in the 70s, or I think it was the 80s, they so perfectly aligned, the dog star so perfectly aligned with the Earth that it actually slowed the Earth down by 5 minutes for 2 weeks. And then as the dog star moved out of that resonating point, pulled us back forward the 5 minutes that had been lost for the 5 minutes that had been lost for the last 2 weeks. That electromagnetism is that strong, folks. And that affects you. We're going to get into this into part two. But this is the music of the universe. That resonating, that magnetism is music, just like the music that comes off the strings of an instrument. And it magnetizes you. And the universe does the same thing, just it doesn't do it acoustically like in an orchestra. It's doing it cosmically with the stars. But it's the same language. That's what the Platonic solids show you. It's this wave language, this language that comes out of the self-organizing aspects of the ether, vortex geometry. And so I'm showing you this so that you can then relate yourself, oh, the energies, the frequencies that were coming off the planets and the constellations as I was forming in Mama's tummy, and as I came out of Mama's womb, affected me because I'm an electromagnetic being. And we're going to talk about that. And it affects you in the same way that hearing an orchestra affects your emotional state, affects your feelings. Music, sound affects you, energizes you, can depress you, motivate you, whatever. It has that power because it's a energy, it's a frequency, it's a vibration. And that's exactly what you are. You're a vibratory creature. You respond to this. It is in you. You can't help it. And so what I'm showing you here is these energies are equated. These are not different energies. And the sooner you can see that, the sooner you will see yourself in it. Because you can see yourself in the music of the orchestra. You can see yourself in the cosmos and the resonation of these orbs, the planets, and stars round about you. You see? The whole overtone series is a series of golden ratios. If you divide an octave by a perfect fifth, 13 20ths, you get the golden ratio. If you divide a perfect fifth by an octave, 8 13ths, you get the golden ratio. If you divide a perfect fourth by a major sixth, 6 tenths, you get the golden ratio. And if you divide a major third by a perfect fifth, 5 eighths, you get the golden ratio. The overtone series is a natural order of notes that is played by horned instruments and found in other instances in music, obviously. Now check this out. Here you see the harmonic series in scale on paper. Here you see the harmonic series inside a conch shell. Do you see? The mathematics that form the pattern that you see written out on that piece of paper, right, is the same mathematics. There it is right in front of you. The same mathematics that form that conch shell. You see? And we are the same ratio. Remember how I showed you the picture in the Fibonacci sequence? And pi, and how all of nature is forming in this self-organizing structure. Okay, that's what this is showing you in real time, and it's just right in your face when you begin to then compare and contrast it to music, and you find that even music self-organizes in the same way. The conch shell is therefore an expression of music, and think of the beauty of that. All physical, here we have Pythagoras, physical matter is music solidified. The music of the universe solidifies into planets, solidifies into galaxies, solidifies into you and me.
were that same organizing, self-organizing, self-complexifying principle. And here I show you, I won't read all of it, and this is where I get it from. Here is the Fibonacci numbers put into scales and octaves, and you can read that if you want to, feel free. Okay, so our final slide for today is this chart of elements and their forms. Now, the reason, okay, first of all, I need to make it very clear. This is straight off of Santos Bonacci's lectures. So this is stolen material. This is not my work. This is not my idea. So make it very clear. This isn't coming from me. This came from Santos. And the reason I'm using it is because he has so eloquently laid out these elements and forms so that you can relate yourself to them. Now, how do you do that? Okay, the whole point of this first lecture has been to relate, oh, we gotta stop the shifting light again, is to relate you to nature, to what you actually authentically are. A return to the archaic. Okay. So this chart shows relationship between the Platonic solids, a mathematical symbol, and actual physical elements in nature, as well as non-physical elements still residing within the realm that is nature. Okay? I hope you can stay with me on this. What I've done here is I have added some stripes to this so that you can see the different sections and what is contained within each section, because these are the relationships that are shared within the stripe. And so what we have here, for example, we have fire. So in alchemy, many of the forms and symbols that they use are given a male or female energy that coincide with it to help you relate to it. Okay, so fire, this burning energy that cuts through, that burns apart, that carries its own light, this is a male-oriented idea. The female in alchemy is more oriented to magnetism, where influence doesn't come through the striking, but it comes through magnetism. This is why women are curvy, because they are filled with magnetism. And so the way their energy influences the universe and others isn't through this, again, this striking idea, this brightness idea, this burning idea that's oriented to the male. Rather, it's more of this cohesive energy that pulls, sort of like the will is not projected out, but pulls in what it wants. And magnetism, like gravity, pulls in what it wants. Water is a female-oriented energy. And so, as you know, and you observe in reality, water quenches fire. And so, there it's not a battle of this, because fire is a higher energy, it then beats, quote-unquote, water. That's a conflictive idea rather than a contrasting idea. And what you want to do is contrast all of these different elements so that you can form relationship to them, so that you can form relationship to them, to one another, to each other. And so if you see it as a conflict, like water is more powerful than fire because water can quench fire, just a splash of water can do it, that's the wrong idea, and it's going to confuse you as you look at this chart. So this chart's, the idea of the chart is to form relationships. So looking at fire and tetrahedron, light, proton, temperature, oxygen. Now, I wanted to stop at oxygen for this reason. The way this energy manifests in chemistry is through oxygen. Now, how do you stay alive? Oxygen. So oxygen keeps you alive, but oxygen is also related to fire. The oxygen that you breathe is also the oxygen that oxidizes you, that causes you to rust to death, that burns you up. So the very thing that's giving you life is also hearkening your death, bringing about your death. This is like the male and female energies. This is the symbolism, this binary, this
contrasting symbolism that's contained within each of these forms and elements. And if you begin to see the relationship of these contrasting energies within each of these, you no longer will see the universe through this conflict-oriented idea, which the sciences and religion and medicine and so forth and government put you into. They want to orient you to conflict so that you understand the world through conflict rather than relationship. Because if I can keep you in conflict, I keep you inflamed. I keep you in the state of inflammation. There's no healing there. There's no uniting there. You see, it's one-sided. And you're going to get lost in yourself and the universe if you see everything as one-sided. Okay, so my computer system is so jank, I can't add more video content because the drive is full. So what I'm going to do is make lemonade out of lemons, and I'm going to keep this slide up, and I'm going to walk with you through a couple of these so that maybe I can help better associate a few for you. So then as you work through it yourself and meditate on it and consider it, you can come up with your own understanding of this. Okay, so like the example I used for fire, oxygen is the chemistry that resonates with the tetrahedron, fire, this male energy. Now look just below that to nitrogen, which resonates with air. Now what do you know about nitrogen? Nitrogen is an inert gas. It's why they use it in Formula One tires. I'm a big Formula One fan. The tires are magnesium, super light. But when they hit a concrete or a stone or steel barrier, if the wheel does, a spark comes out. And if you got tires full of oxygen, right, you're going to have an explosion. But if they're full of nitrogen, an inert gas, well, nothing happens. And what do we know about air? It's an insulator. Fire burns through. Air insulates. What insulates the earth? The atmosphere. Air. If you ask a HVAC tech, he'll tell you the best insulator is air. Okay, so you have an entirely different type of resonation, even though you're still working with a gas, meaning air, because fire is just an inflamed gas. It's a burning gas. It's plasma. Okay, and speaking of which, look just above that to the ether. Its chemistry is plasma. Okay, well, that's totally different than oxygen and nitrogen. Plasma is ions, is composed of ions. Ions are atoms that have their electrons have been liberated. And so the plasma is a flowing of liberated electrons. Okay? And it happens under heat and pressure or a vacuum. Plasma is the fifth element. It's not a gas. It's not water. It's not earth. It's not fire. It's outside of those things, which is why, as part of the ether, is outside of description. You see how plasma then ties in so well with the element ether. Okay, and then space. What do you see, still looking at ether there under state, what do you see in the universe? You see space. Okay, and what do you see in space is you see nebulae. What are nebulae? Plasma. Do you see? And material is void or electron, right? The electron is, that's what plasma is, flowing electrons. And what is the characteristic of the ether? Consciousness. You can't put consciousness into words. Consciousness is a part of your mind, which doesn't exist. You see, so consciousness, there's the now you see it, now you don't aspect right there in the ether. And look at that under sense, the gut sense. It's the gut mind. It's like when you walk into a room and just something is wrong, something is off, something isn't right. That's your gut mind, and your gut mind knows everything. That's why it's a part of the ether. the Akashic field, right? And that kingdom is angelic. You see how it all fits together? You see how all these resonate together? Look at continuing with fire, oxygen, intuition. This is to know, knowledge, which is the fire that burns inside of you, knowingness, which quenches fear. Right? This is a the mode is spirit. Look above that. The ether is love. The mode is love. You see these things? Sense, sight. Fire carries its own light. It's the only one of the four, fire, air, water, earth, that carries its own light. The fire is light, you see, and the kingdom is human. That's the burning energy inside of you. The animating feature of you is your intellect, your soul. Right? And so this the kingdom there is the human kingdom. Right? And just below that is the animal kingdom. Right? It's not, the animal is more passive, essentially, than the human. The human being can build empires and skyscrapers and trains and airplanes and flying machines and all this kind of stuff. And that is a step above in consciousness than the animal. Do you see this? You see how these all relate? And that's the air. But this all compose the nature. And then you have there with air, the sense is hearing. And hearing is compression and rarefaction of air molecules. That's how your eardrum moves in and out. I think I get into that in one of these upcoming talks. Right? And this the characteristic is thinking. Right? Thinking you can't, it's not tangible. It's air. It's not tangible. You can't grab it. You can't see it. Right? But it's there. And this is your mind thinking. You see how these all relate? Do you see this? Cohesion underwater. How does your DNA hold together? See, under physics and water, right there is cohesion. How does your DNA hold together? It holds together through water molecules. That's the cohesion that holds the proteins that form the DNA together. And look under material. See, you have up there the ether, the void, right? Then proton, one of the smallest things that exists, right there with the boson, which would be above in the ether, right? Bosons would fit into the ether. That might be a better description for the material of the ether, but anyway. Because bosons are both in this reality and out of this reality. They're both in time and out of time. I might change that for future. And then under air, we have material with atom, which is larger than a proton. And then water, a particle, which is a group of atoms. And then a group of particles forms a molecule, and that's the earth. Do you see how it's getting larger and larger? The vibration is getting lower and lower as you go down. That's not bad. I'm just saying that's the frequency. Do you see how these all tie together? That's what this chart can open to you, so that you see the relationship between all of these different characteristics, forms, and elements in nature. And by relating all of these things together, you then are automatically, just without even trying, you then are related right there to nature, because you're composed of oxygen, nitrogen, hydrogen, carbon, knowing, feeling, thinking, atoms, liquid, solids, space. All of this is burning inside you. Love, guts, your gut mind. You see this? Sight, spirit. These are all part of you. You see that? Relates you right there to the basics of nature. And so the whole point of this chart here is to relate all of these things to each other so that you see the oneness within all of this. So then you also see the oneness within yourself and nature. There's then, therefore, no conflict. It's simply a contrast, and it's realizing the universe through this contrasting idea rather than this conflictive idea, which causes alienation, which causes infighting and war and tribalism and hierarchy. These will disrelate you to yourself and to nature and to everyone else, because you're not going to find unity through conflictive ideas. You're going to find unity through contrasting ideas. Okay, so what you can do then is, as you study this chart, this is a chart you're going to have to look at and study. It's not something like, okay, I read it, it's good, we're all good, we're moving on like the page of a book. You're going to have to put effort participate in extracting out the hidden language, just like the Platonic solids are hiding a language. You're going to have to extract out of this chart the hidden language of unity, the hidden language of contrasting to understand. And by doing that, you not only mature yourself, but you bring about an understanding of the universe that's past institutions, that's past an institutional idea, an institutionalized idea of yourself and the universe. Because each person is going to relate to this differently. They're going to see these energies differently than you do. And the idea is like what Bastian is, and I'll finish up with this, and the idea harkens back to what I talked about with Bastian. Everybody's talking about the same unifying concept, the elementary idea, but everyone has a different folklore. Everyone has a different folk idea of how they relate to these energies. And in the same way that you have your own wardrobe of clothing and someone else has their own wardrobe of clothing, it's going to be totally different than yours because they relate differently to clothing than you do. But it doesn't make one kind of clothing better than another. They're just unique. And the idea is to see the beauty in this, in nature. The idea is to beautify nature through relating it, through magnetism, through this female energy. You're relating things rather than trying to understand things through conflict and beating things into submission, into believing and thinking in the same way, which is robotics, which you don't want. The human being is a firework, is a magnificent display that's here and gone. And the beauty is the uniqueness of each of the fireworks, because that creates the show, that creates the magnificence, that creates the dance. You see what I'm saying? Okay, and so what I'm trying to do here with these four videos is to offer you four different kinds of dancing. You see, this is using the expression that Alan Watts used to use. In that, dancing isn't trying to get you anywhere. I'm sorry, I'm getting emotional. Dancing isn't trying to get you anywhere. It's simply expressing the beauty that is life, like music. It's here and gone. The dancers aren't trying to get anywhere on the stage any more than the music is trying to get somewhere in physical space. The beauty is its presence. And that's what I'm trying to do with these four videos, is just show you a presence, is show you a relationship, an understanding of the world and yourself that is past any definition. You see, and if you can relate on that level, nothing, no one, no institution can take you, can take advantage of you and exploit you. Because you will be on a higher level. You will be operating on a higher frequency. And that is exactly what the Buddha was talking about. Enlightenment. That is exactly what kenosis is about. Enlightenment. Operating on a level that is past the physical illusion that is the world. You see? Okay. I'll see you guys in part two. Love you guys. Thanks for sticking around. I'm sorry it's taken so long. Thanks for sticking around. We'll see you in part two. Bye-bye.